Because we have Cloud9 Maelstrom going to be taking on newcomers Tuark. Neither of these teams are new, but Tuark, this is their first qualifier that they've actually gotten into the top eight for.
Yeah, we are going to be seeing them in the round of eight. It is the first time. They weren't quite able to make it there in June, but let's take a look at some of the stats that we do have for Tuark so far. Tuark is known for being a very innovative team. They have some very crazy plays, and picking up some of those heroes that we don't often see prioritized by other teams, like this Falstad that we're seeing in the most picked heroes.
That's right.
I like that shout out to CS Steve. Big shout out to him.
Ooh, yeah, actually, you're right. I forgot that was really, really old school. We're talking like back of March of last year that these competitive teams were playing. But just goes to show you how long the organization has been in the Heroes esports scene. So really cool to see that. Kudos to those guys. But we can't also forget about Cloud9 Maelstrom, the other team on the other side. And that is going to be their record right there. 6-0, an impressive team. They always have excellent tournament placings. Their most played map is Blackheart's Bay. That is the image for Tomb of the Spider Queen, so apologies for that, guys. Their most picked heroes are Taranda and Arthas, actually, surprisingly. So that's probably, I would guess, you know, from the stats taken from their ride up into the qualifier, because, you know, Arthas, not something that we would have seen previous to this event.
Well, I mean, as I said, Arthas has kind of had a big resurgence. We've seen Sony, we've seen Arthas, now Gazlo. I mean, the sky's the limit at this point, Gilly.
It really, really is. And, you know, with 6-0 as their record, that is going to be a tough charge for Tuark to be able to take there.
All right, so guys, just before we jump into it, reminder, Heroes of the Storm to the North America Road to BlizzCon is brought to you by our official hardware partners of Gigabyte and NVIDIA, two top-notch sponsors out there, and we do thank them for their generosity in order to make this event happen. That being said, we have a draft for you, so let's get right on into it. What will Tuark bring to the table? Well, that is the question on everybody's mind.
All right, well, they will start with their ban, and it looks like we'll see a ban on the Asmodan, and this is very common. We've seen this a lot on Tomb of the Spider Queen. They don't want to have to deal with that very late game potential from Cloud9 Maelstrom.
Yeah, absolutely. Asmodan out, the Taranda out. Tomb of the Spider Queen as the battleground of choice. Not a big surprise to see Asmodan out.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. Jaina also makes a lot of sense. Or maybe what's a bit more normal? And we've seen a lot of abnormal stuff today, so
what is
maybe a breath of fresh air, I don't know. But what this means is that Ceratul will be picked up for the first time today. First time this weekend, a strong hero, and I can almost guarantee you that Cloud9 Maelstrom is willing to show you why he's so strong.
Oh, he is so strong indeed. He's going to be able to drop one of those Void Prisons. In fact, let's take a little look at some of the talents that we will have for Ceratul, since it is the first time we'll be seeing him. We're going to be looking at Tassadar, his Protoss brother, and we've seen him a couple of times. His big boon as definitely his oracle, which allows him to provide a lot of vision. This is going to be so integral on this battleground because there are two turn-in points that he'll want to be able to show to his teammates to see if his opponents are turning in.
Yeah, level 4, mental acuity coming into things could really just give a lot of information to the team. So as a first pick round for Maelstrom, that actually solidifies, you know, the Protoss Brethren honoring the legacy of the Void, which we have now seen a lot of actually marketing about, because I'm extremely hyped for that. These guys are extremely hyped for that. Another thing to point out, as Uther is going to go here to Tuark, is that Cloud9 Maelstrom recently got a new team member who excels at melee assassins. So I cannot imagine Fan is really too disappointed that his first game of the day is going to be Azeratul.
Yep. Another good point to bring up with the Tassadar as well is that he actually is a pretty good counter to what we see for Ceratul. So the fact that they're picking that up, I think there's sort of a denial pick. They don't want Tuark to be able to scoop that up. We see a double support.
You want to talk about
Jester's like throwing his hands up. He's like, what am I looking at right now? We knew we were going to see some weird things with Tuark, and maybe this is sort of fitting into that style.
You want to talk about a denial pick, and this kind of looks like it right there. They're going to not only grab the Uther, make sure that they can deny that divine shield on top of the Ceratul, but they're also going to get Malfurion, and I can kind of bet that we might see their ban come out on Rhaegar.
That is 100% likely to be happening at this point. If it isn't, well, I mean, I'm glad I'm not in the analyst chair anymore, but Mirrodin is going to actually be the counter ban here from Cloud9. They want to make sure that they take away that strong engage, and Cloud9 Maelstrom is actually going to get that first crack at a warrior there as well, so you can almost guarantee Johanna will go over to them, and as you said, Miss Gila, right on the money, Rhaegar.
There it is.
Okay, so Cloud9 Maelstrom now has to sort of scramble to figure out what they're doing for their support. They can probably leave that to their last pick, as there's no immediate rush. Well, I don't know. It's 2-arc.
You say sometimes. That. You say that to me.
It is. But I would guess that 2-arc, now that Muradin is out of the picture, probably will be looking at Tyrael. Does that sound a little bit crazy to you guys? I'm just thinking that they need that follow-up to punish Lili.
Not at all.
For the Jug of 1,000 Cups. So we'll see. Uther, maybe you could make a case that we'll have the ability to get in there to disrupt. Try to disrupt. There we go. But, you know, it's melee. All those things are out of range or lack of. And Tyrael with the Judgment, it could be a strong pick.
They could indeed. And of course, 2-arc love Tyrael. We often see them prioritize picking him up as their warrior of choice, even over some of the other ones. And there he is. We're going to be rewarded. Shall we take a look at maybe his character card and see what exactly he'll be doing as well? And there it is. He's going to have a lot of mobility with both Smite and Eldrin's Might. But you mentioned it. It's the Judgment. Mm-hmm. He can move straight in, stun someone, push everyone else back from that person. And from there, they can very quickly throw a ton of damage on him and take him out.
However, can't count the amount of times that I have casted 2-arc games where they play Tyrael, and I'm like, oh yeah, they're going for the Judgment and then Sanctification. Just keep that possibility in mind. It's something that could happen. They round out their composition with Zagara on Tomb of the Spider Queen. I think that makes a lot of sense.
Yep, good vision control to counter out up against Tassadar. Of course, Oracle kind of does actually beat out Creep Tumor at this point because one will reveal the other. And as we were mentioning, Lili is going to be the last pickup here for Cloud9 Maelstrom because I guess Brightwing just doesn't exist to some of these teams.
I guess not, indeed. It makes me very sad. I miss the fairy dragon, but it's cool to see the little panda as well.
Well, we have to see if they are going to do battle well enough to actually earn Lili her first win here, as we've now seen her a few times, not only in the Open, but now into the top eight. And Kubi, last thoughts before we jump into the game?
Well, I actually like the pickup that 2-arc has with the double support into Tyrael. I think that makes a lot of sense. But you really need to make sure that you have the damage follow-up to sort of burst that out to sustain throughout the rest of the fight, I guess, if that makes any sense. But it's really going to come down to the interactions with Lili and how well 2-arc is sort of able to throw Maelstrom off their game during the team fights to punish them for that.
All right, so as we get load on into it, ladies and gentlemen, we do have game number one of our fourth set of the day. It will be 2-arc here on the left-hand side. Furious D, Pannucci, Chubbs, Tsukii, and Traitorr going to be making up the blue team.
And over on the red side, we will have Cloud9 Maelstrom with Zeratul being played by Fan. Of course, Tassadar will be played by K1 Pro. Johanna will be being rocked by KingCaffeine. Kael'thas played by iDream. And rounding it out, Lili played by DunkTrain.
Oh, that train whistle is going to get ready, because if we see a Lili win here, people everywhere in Heroes of the Storm are going to be like, see, viable, no problem. But it is Cloud9 Maelstrom. They're the second seed coming into this. They did actually perform very well there back in June. They're looking for the win here as well to advance. But 2-arc, that Tyrael, like, how many invulnerabilities do we have on this team?
Oh, so many, yeah, indeed. And they're going to have a very strong engagement as well if they do end up picking up that Judgment with lots of slows and stuns to follow from the rest of the team. Logana, we are going to have a lot of rotations. This is, of course, Tomb of the Spider Queen. So we're going to see them rotating around, trying to maybe get some picks. And in fact, we have a Hammer of Justice going down on Cloud9 Fan. He's going to have to jump right back.
Yep, so Fan, he's just going to poke in, poke out. He's actually having a heck of a time landing really any kind of big damage. With double healers ready to go here from 2-arc, especially this early on, a lot of his instant harass is just going to get patched up pretty quickly.
Yeah, indeed it is. And there's another Hammer of Justice, but Tassadar very difficult to be able to take out. So for now, we're seeing a lot of heroes down in this bottom lane. I think Maelstrom are just really nervous about trying to let Furious D on that Zagara just get any sort of push in, because with that, you can start doing damage to the structures, and then, of course, start spreading that creep even more.
Yep, the top lane is a little bit of a wet noodle fight, so, I mean, there's just nothing really going on down up there. It's all about the party into this bottom lane. You can see Furious D, he's trying to spread out that creep, but right now, Cloud9 Maelstrom are really just on top of that creep spread. We do have a roaming ambush into the top lane, though, and Pannucci, he's going to throw that sword over the wall, but I'm not sure that's enough, Gilly.
Oh, no, the Condemn goes in, a Flame Strike as well, but he will be able to get away thanks to a great heal up by Chubbs, and now they are getting a rotation of their own and maybe trying to pick up one of these members of Maelstrom, but not going to be able to do so.
Something I have noticed is that we've actually left Lili on that Dunk Train into the bottom lane, so all of a sudden, you see a big resurgence of push coming up from Zagara, as we have the rotations now passing mid, and very likely trying to, once again, just contain the creep into the bottom.
At least they do have the Tassadar. Every time you drop that Oracle, as long as a tumor is nearby, they will be able to see that and then more easily be able to clear up that creep. Sometimes you do have difficulty with that. Now, Maelstrom are doing a really good job of maintaining their soak. They've also picked up their level 4 talents just a smidge before 2-arc.
Yeah, so Cloud9 Maelstrom is actually going to be running Mento Acuity there with that Tassadar. So again, looking for that information control. Tuark Chubbs does not opt for that Scouting Drone at level 1. He actually has Moonburn, and ooh, big stuns, big damage on DunkTrain.
And DunkTrain's trying very hard to get away as that Lili will be able to get into the root, though. And now Furious D with a great blast hit will be able to take her down.
Yep, now it does look like Tuark, they're going to be just on the defensive. They spent a lot of resources trying to take down the little panda, and well, they did it, but unfortunately not really too much left in the tank. So they're all going to hit the fountain, hit the gym, so to speak, and just revitalize. Come on back. Now we do got some mercenaries into the bottom lane, so that will dictate Tuark's movements for now, but they also have their level 5s, their level 4s. And once again, you know, I'm going to talk a lot about Malfurion probably because I'm very interested to see what the build will be, but he does have the Alun's Grace, so the extra range going forward for all of his abilities.
And that's going to be very nice, too. If we do see the Judgment, they can throw Judgment straight into an Entangling Roots a little bit easier, really getting a lockdown, and maybe even could we see a Divine Storm? I kind of wondered about that with the two supports.
Well, I mean, with the double support, one of them could very well go for a little bit more of an offensive way to go, but already, you know, Pannucci taking the offense on that one, but it is the unstoppable KingCaffeine on Johanna.
It is indeed. She's got that iron skin. She can get away if she gets into a situation where there are a lot of roots or other types of CC going down. And now we do have teams starting to turn in these gems. They need to get up to 50. And so far, Tuark has done a better job of doing this. And this is indicative of the fact that they do have that creep and they can control the vision a little bit easier.
Yeah, that bottom turn is going to be really hard to kind of sneak in uncontested if you are on the Maelstrom. But Pannucci, again, he's looking at a dire spot. Is that an ignite? That is an ignite. And Tyrio will actually be the first take down here for Maelstrom.
And a great job by that. They're going to be able to retain around 23 gems on iDream and 22 on KingCaffeine, so they really want to get those turned in. Traitorr doing his best to try to deny this, but so far actually not going to be able to get those turned in. They're going after Tsukii instead.
All right, level 7 is coming in. Maelstrom, I mean, they have a little bit of an edge coming into this one. If they are looking for that turn in, this is probably their best window of opportunity to do it.
Yeah, it definitely is, and they're trying so hard, but Tuark is doing a really great job of consistently denying this, and now they've picked up the level 7s of their own, so they've staved off this window, and they're going to be able to at least stop one of those heroes from turning in.
Oh, Fanny's going to find Traitorr. This actually could lead us into something good.
It is indeed, and there goes the Blizzard to try to stave off the damage or at least do some damage of her own, but she will go down. Now Chubb's taking a ton of damage as well. Flamestrike's going to ensure that that takedown happens as well.
All right, a few more takedowns now to the name. The map presence is looking good here for Maelstrom, but they're not done yet. They are going to spread. It does look like Fan is going to head downtown into the party lane, but the Red Web Weavers are now going to be on their way. Kael'thas with that turn in top. Zagara bottom, not looking good. She is about to drop, and very curious that she actually hasn't yet.
Yeah, wow. I'm just
she made it. Wow. She actually used the creep highway to make it away.
Well, I think she did pick up that reconstitution, which is going to definitely help with that regeneration when she is on the creep. But we do have web weavers spawning. So this will be the first web weaver spawn of the game. A lot of times we see these early web weaver spawns. It'll just be a team looking to push in and maybe take out some towers. You don't often see them going in for a fort unless they can get some takedowns, because it is a little bit risky of a positioning that you're putting yourselves into.
Yeah, so the first turn in, we see this on a lot of actually battlegrounds. I mean, it doesn't get the big value unless you have a huge advantage going forward. So going into this, I mean, yeah, it's a slight level advantage going for Cloud9 Maelstrom. What are they going to hope to achieve in here? At least some towers. Can they get a fort? That's a big question that I'm not entirely too sure they have the comp to do it, because they got to go through Zagara, they got to go through Jaina, and double supports. You're not really going to get a pick off during this phase, I think.
No, I don't think so either, but what they can hope to do is definitely look for a good rotation, take out as many towers as they possibly can as well, and then look to try to get those heroic abilities before their opponents. If they can continue to maintain that lane presence, keep those lanes pushed in their advantage, then maybe they can go into another turn in right afterwards and then look to take down some of those forts.
All right, so we've already seen some big aggression from Fan. He's roaming around. He's got the Zeratul. He's very happy that he's on that Zeratul. I mean, the melee assassin, that's more or less the reason why he was actually put into Maelstrom, because they didn't really have a big melee assassin. And Fan, he won the Heroes of the Dorm. He knows Illidan by the back of his hand. Zeratul and him are close buds. Kerrigan, sure, maybe a little bit, but the Butcher, he's been absolutely fantastic on the Butcher. So now into this with the Zeratul, he's really been making that mark show. He goes into one lane, ganks it out, hits another, and we've been spreading out a lot of rotations from Tuark, but so far, the takedowns have really gone into favor of Maelstrom this early game.
It has indeed. Now, what do you think that Tuark needs to do in order to make sure that they're not getting too far behind in this early game?
So if it was me kind of in their shoes at that point, the creep tumors are a big thing. You might want to start rotating around the Zagara. That way, at least the Zeratul will rotate with you. Into the bottom lane, she hasn't really been getting a lot done. I mean, she almost came down to death at the end of that because the Zeratul was just able to roam right through. And if you're not looking, he's not on the minimap. You don't have an icon. And if you're not looking specifically at that point and there's no call-out, well, I mean, it's a dangerous situation. So if he can actually ping-pong and start setting up a lot of creeps, you have to, you know, expend some resources in order to clear them. So if you're spending resources, you get that little blip on the map, the creep's gone, you know someone's there. Might be a little bit safer for them, but in the early game aggression game, Tuark doesn't really have a lot of cards to play. Double support doesn't really lead you into a lot.
No, it definitely does not. And we do seem to have some technical difficulties, guys. So we're going to check out one of the players from Tuark. It will be their captain, Furious D. So we're going to take a little bit of a look at him. He is one of the flex carry players. And right there with the most picked hero, you can see he is picking up Kael'thas there as one of his favorite heroes of choice. Also practice magician / sleight of hand artist there. That's pretty cool to see. And maybe they can use that in some way to go to their advantage.
It's kind of interesting to see a lot of the backstories, what these guys like to play, what they like to do when they're not playing. I mean, DunkTrain in these videos, just like, what do I do when I don't play heroes? But we got jesters, we got magicians, we got musicians, we got math bachelor's holders. Like, there's a lot of different big things that are a huge interest out of this. And, you know, King Caffeine, he's no different. He definitely has a little bit going on for him outside of this because he fenced with a saber in college. Like, how cool is that?
What is that? That is so crazy. He also really likes stitches, and that kind of makes sense. I mean, a saber, a hook, it kind of works, right?
Maybe? On guard with the hook. Well, miss, 0 points. All right, very similar indeed. But, you know, stitches as a most picked, I haven't seen him picked yet.
I know, right? It's been quite a while indeed. Yeah. What I'm kind of thinking is, looking at these talents so far, we might need to set up some sort of Heroes of the Storm circus troupe. I mean, we've got jugglers and...
All we need is a ringleader.
I know, right? I can do that. Give me a top hat. I'm ready to go.
All right. Gilly's going to be our ringleader. We got magicians, drummers, and jesters. I mean, it's a heck of a time to be here in Heroes. Another big player in this match. You know, we don't really talk a lot about Tuark because, well, this is their first time here. But Chubbs, the very personable, the very, talkative team member of Chubbs, he actually runs quite a few guides out there on support. Not really too much of a surprise to see Uther as his big first, most picked hero, but he was a running back in football and has a family of 5 sugar gliders as pets. I'm not going to lie. I don't know what those are.
They're like these little monkey... They're not really monkeys. They're like rodent-type small... They're very, very loud at night is the one thing that I know about them. So now we have, what, 15 cats? 14 cats? 13?
Yeah, we had a team member in June with 15 cats. Yeah.
Yes, and then 5 sugar gliders. So lots of animals and a circus troupe at that.
Oh, man, we are just really building up the stable here as time goes on. Now, we talked about this a little bit earlier. Last time we saw Fan, he was on Cloud9 Vortex. Now he's playing with Cloud9 Maelstrom. I've said this before, he was the hero of the dorm. This is the guy that basically took Illidan all the way to pay for his schooling, which was really cool. I mean, Illidan's a great hero, but and he's his most picked. Not a surprise. But he was the captain of his high school varsity badminton team, and he's been going to the gym every day for over a year. Him and Kubi must have tons to talk about while they press 500-pound weights together.
That is some serious commitment. But you mentioned it before, he is such a fantastic melee assassin player. Mm-hmm. So much so that when we saw at Dorm, it was almost as if teams were just trying to get Illidan as fast as possible just so that he wouldn't have the Illidan, because it was fearsome to see Fan on it.
So when he got the Zeratul and it got through the band, like the picks band, when we were back in the drafts, it's like, all right, surrounded band, okay. And the first pick wasn't actually a Zeratul, it was a Jaina. It's just like, all right, didn't really think of it. But then the first pick for the second team for Zeratul and its Fan, like, he couldn't have been happier. Like, he just gets that hero on a small map with that does actually encourage melee interactions. You see a lot of ambushes now set up. He's been part of almost every takedown for his team. He might not have enough gems to kind of dunk down and get those web weavers, but he is making sure that he's thinning out the herd for the opponents. And they, if they can't hold on to their gems, then I think he's done his job.
Yeah, that's definitely the case. When you lose those gems, you don't, in fact, you don't give them to your opponent. team, but you also don't, you only have a small amount of time before you can actually pick them up. Your team members can grab them for themselves. Otherwise, they're just going to disappear. And that is heartbreaking when you have so many gems and you lose them in a battle.
And that is kind of the overarching theme of this map. You have to either put them down or you have to risk them in battle. And if you risk them in battle and you come out on the wrong side of it, you're probably never going to get those web weavers. So, I mean, yeah. It's a small map, but there's a big objective, and a lot of this will go around, you know, how well will Fan work on this? And unfortunately, we can't seem to bring him or his team back, Ms. Gilly, so it does look like we're just going to take a quick break here as we sort out our technical difficulties, guys. Stay tuned. The match will continue. You can guarantee it. We'll see you then.
The first Hellscream. You were destined to be my greatest champion. And instead, you chose this. You have no vision. Behold, what a true seat of power demands. A citadel of hellish fire worthy of my masters. A monument to entomb the souls of all who would dare to defy us.
They will defy you. I have seen their forces in battle. They are fearless. It does not matter what vile creatures you summon to the battle. They will persevere. Their resolve is unbreaking. They will come. They will fight. And they will wash their blades of your blood in victory.
Fight if you must, Hellscream. It is no matter. In the end, we all serve the Legion.
This is a dream of mine to be a professional gamer, and this is like giving us the opportunity to be professional gamers.
The road to BlizzCon's pretty big for players.
Being able to play in like the actual Blizzard official tournaments, it's definitely like a dream come true.
That's like the dream, to make it to BlizzCon.
It's pretty awesome just to be able to compete in top 8, especially in North American Open. Like, we feel like it's still like a pretty wide open for a new team to come in and like really grow.
There's very little research that teams can do on us. They won't be able to see what we're gonna bring out.
I wanna basically be the best. I don't want Heroes to be a reality to me.
The decision right now is to go pro in Heroes.
I personally just want to be known as the best, honestly. That's all there is to it.
Despite me not being around
that long or being an unknown name, I'm not like Arthalon, I can still be considered one of the best players in the world.
Even if you're the favorites, you can never ever underestimate enemy teams. They can always have a strategy or be working on something you don't know about, so you just always have to be prepared.
For me, it's kind of just like I want to like lead my team and be a good leader and be able to inspire other people.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. It does look like the RNG gods are on our favor because we're back into the game.
All right, and we are back into it. Looks like heroic abilities have been picked up by Maelstrom, and I did think I saw a Phoenix. We'll have to update you guys with the rest of those as we can get them. Now, two Arc are going to be looking to try to grab them themselves here.
All right, so level 10 coming forward there for Maelstrom. They do have those heroics, as we did just states. We lost a little bit of time in between. Three takedowns to one, back and forth, but a boss? I mean, this is called the throw pit for a reason. Will Cloud9 be able to hold it?
Now, two Arc are going to see this because they get the turn in, but the Void Prison will go down, and that means the boss will be picked up by Maelstrom, and they might be going in for this fight, too, while their opponents are not have heroics. Jaina will go down. The Archon starting to throw a lot of damage down, and Malfurion will also be taken out of this fight.
Well, it was a good idea for Malfurion to go into that, but typically you have the Warrior actually lead that charge. Terio nowhere to be found, and now with this top wave actually pushing in with this boss. I mean, we have actually Blue Webweavers on the map, but you know, that's cool. We're just going to take this fort.
Yeah, they're only pushed down to the middle, so they sent Kael'thas to try to deal with that, but this fort pickup is huge for Maelstrom now. And two Arc are going to be able to clean up this boss, pick up their heroics of their own, but not getting very much done with those Webweavers.
Yep, iDream there in the mid, as we just saw, was able to clean up with virtually no damage on it, and perhaps a tower into the bottom lane. Well, sure, it's a little bit of experience to go the way of two Arc, who do now actually have those heroics ready to go, but this has really put them in a bad spot because the fort down, they didn't get any real value out of those Webweavers, and now they don't have the pressure of actually another turn in, which means that Cloud9 Maelstrom is basically free to do as they see fit at this point.
They are indeed. It looks like part of that is going to be trying to clear out some of the creep. There's no creep remaining on this bottom turn-in point. And two Arc, their time to push is pretty much closed. They're going to have to be pushed back here and watching out for the engagement from Cloud9.
All right, so if we actually wait a little bit here, Maelstrom will hit 13, which is another big power spike with those talents coming in. That'll be a talent tier advantage as well. It's likely not Maelstrom that will get aggressive on this, as they are just very content to wait. But if 2ARC wants to get anything done, now is their window of opportunity before that 13 hits.
Yeah, and it looks like they want to try to get rid of some of those gems so they don't feel so bad about getting aggressive there. Their window is quickly closing. Will we see the judgment from Pannucci? Caffeine is in there trying to pull in some members, maybe get somebody out of position, but so far has not been able to do so. But there is the judgment onto Fan, and a great Divine Storm tries to lock him down as well, but does not do so. He's going to be able to blink away.
Yep, the Maw's down there. You see the Water Elemental as well. Lots of low hit points across the board, and two takedowns going towards 2ARC. They do actually now have this big man advantage going into this one. The Dimensional Shift is there, but K1 Pro unfortunately does not have a second one in the reserve, and he is actually going to drop. So 2ARC, they really made that happen.
They did indeed. We saw the Divine Storm. We saw the lockdown they had, and it looked a little scary from them at first when they didn't grab that Zeratul, but the Maw was so powerful, and from this, they are just going to push in on this mid. They want to trade and get a fort of their own.
So a big thing there is that since we already had the Void Prison still down from the boss, that was out of the equation. We saw the Maw actually take down the Malfurion, who had the train... Not the Malfurion, sorry, take down the Lili. We didn't have any real kind of big hewing support there from Maelstrom, and then two quick takedowns, and then eventually that Tassler as well leads into a fort. This could actually be another turn in, ready to go. Five gems short, just a little bit too few in order to get that done. But the big thing is the experience lead has basically been decimated.
Yes, they're about to pick up their 13 talents of their own, and Fan desperate to try to turn in. He's got 23 gems. He's going to try to trade some blows with Pannucci, who's not going to be able to follow him as he can blink out of there. Now 2ARC, they have the gems. It's going to be a race to see who can get the turn in, but they're doing such a great job of protecting Furious D, and it will be Blue Webweavers for 2ARC.
Fan's a little bit disappointed on that one. He should actually have that Void Prison up, as well as a few other heroics out and about, but level 13 is here from 2ARC, and based upon that momentum from the last team fight, it is, you know, rather desirable, I think, at this point for 2ARC to kind of engage now with the Webweavers on their side. They want to make sure that they get some value out of this big push.
Yeah, because the Webweavers push to wherever the lane is currently pushed, they're going to choose to try to hurry up and push the lane on top, try to help that Webweaver move around as fast as possible, try to maybe even get some of these towers down so the Webweaver can go directly to the fort, start taking down some of those more important structures there.
All right, you also see, again, you know, iDream basically on the other lane duty. He will clean up mid. The rest of the team did clean up bottom. Now they're coming top. This could be a big team fight because we're really far pushed here from 2ARK.
They are indeed, and they realize that they're going to move back, but Pannucci's got to be careful as there is the condemn from Caffeine. Not going to grab anything, just instead working to take down those minions as fast as possible.
All right, so we saw a stun there on top of K1 Pro. He's okay. Phoenix is coming out. That's right. It's going to be up in 45 seconds anyways. Still a little bit of pressure here on this fort. The mid was already cleared out. Top, unfortunately, didn't go down to the pressure here of 2ARK as well. But again, you know, they have really patched up that experience. It's just slightly in the favor of Maelstrom rather than just the two levels. And Fan, all the way bottom, no one sees him. Here comes the red.
There is the turn in, and this is great for Maelstrom because they already do have that mid and bottom lane so far pushed. Even top is in the middle, considering the fact that we just had Webweavers. They've been putting out a fantastic defense versus the two Webweavers in a row from 2ARK, and now they may get a lot of done here. But right now, Tsukii is on the chase, wants to be able to try to catch Johanna, won't be able to do so thanks to her trait.
Yeah, you saw Tsukii, he was just kind of keeping pace, but he didn't throw out that fist adjustment, the judgment, because, you know, it was an unstoppable Johanna. You can't really do anything about that. The bigger issue is that now we don't have a water elemental for the next upcoming fight from 2ARK. This could lead us into an advantage and aggression, especially with the red Webweavers on the deck, for Maelstrom.
Indeed, and now Maelstrom are a full level ahead of 2ARK, so with some structure takedowns, they're going to be getting dangerously close to those level 16 talents, which are also important in battle. This fort is going to go down. A great Phoenix there to help zone.
Yep, fort is down, and Pannucci, you know, a little bit low on the hit points. We'll get that heal, but it's the heal over time. It's not exactly the hit points that you need at demand, but left to his own devices, he will heal up no problem. It does look like Maelstrom is content just to take that, and it looks like the rotation from 2ARK will actually end this threat of the red Webweavers, but there's no collapse from Maelstrom. It looks like they are just going to play it a bit patiently and get those 16 towns you're just talking about.
Yeah, they're really content to do that because they did sit in the middle and kind of distract 2ARK a little bit. Not only did they get the fort there, but the lane is super pushed out now and bottom toward them. It's taken down the gate. It started to put pressure on those towers as well. And now we do have them picking up their bruisers. So they're going to continually have a very strong lane push for presence. But 2ARK is just checking the boss. I thought we were going to go for it. I got a little scared there for them. But no, they're just going to check it, make sure that's not where Maelstrom are.
Nope, nobody actually seems to know where Fan is at this point because he's way there in the bottom. Doesn't look like the mercenaries of the Siege Giants will start pushing for Maelstrom and level 16 now acquired. iDream specifically hits extremely scary at this tier on that Kael'thas because we have Flamethrower and now Ignite on that top, on that as well.
Oh, can you imagine the damage of that along with the Archon, especially from the Void Prison from Zeratul. And now, once again, we're going to have a double Webweaver spawn in a row, but this time it'll be from Maelstrom, who is going to be able to push in the bottom lane, it looks like, as they've still got a half of a level before their opponents catch up in the same talent tier. So they're going to be feeling very good about being so far out on the battleground right now.
Yep, 2ARK with only the 15. They don't have that same talent tier, so the advantage is here to Maelstrom. The big defensive posturing here from 2ARK as well. There already goes down a little bit of poke.
Indeed, and 2ARK, we have to also talk about the psychology of this right now because they have so many gems on their persons, especially that Pannucci, who's not known for being a super tanky warrior. He could be taken down, first down very easily, especially with that Ignite like you mentioned. A Phoenix is going to go out to zone. There goes the Condemn. So far, just a very postured in defense for 2ARK, not wanting to engage, wanting to get level 16 as well first.
Yeah, and they're basically, their hands are tied into this bottom lane, mid pushing, top pushing. There's no force, but it's going to start landing on top of those keep gates, and wow, already Pannucci, he's just going to go have to back to those holes. Storms at this point.
Indeed he is, and this is a little better time for Maelstrom to push. They're feeling very aggressive. They're all the way right up to that fort, as they do have such great poke between those Psionic Storms and the Flame Strikes with Ignite as well. But they're going to go ahead and back off. They see their opponents almost have their 16 talents. They realize that it could be very easy to see the 2ARK with a very strong engagement with that Judgment. So instead they're going to rotate around. Actually, if they can catch out Pannucci here, that'd be huge. The Condemn goes down. He's getting so many heals though from that double support, and he's going to be moving in now as well.
So it was a little bit of a scary moment there for the Angel, but he will be all right. But again, top lane, the gate is gone. In fact, top lane might even get a keep at this point because the rest of 2ARK is still posturing and trying to chase down into the bottom lane. Cloud9 Fan at this point as well, he could also just throw down the Void Prison and still more and more damage would go down. Already you see Zagara now up to the top, but the gate was gone and that's a half hit point keep. Mid actually fared out a little bit better, only the gate is gone, but still, you're setting yourself up for a monster advantage going forward.
And especially if they they can pick up that boss, which will push down that top lane. Maelstrom with such good distraction tactics. And now look at the amount of gems on Pannucci. He's got 30 now on his person. He really does not want to lose those, as that would be a huge blow, especially if his his teammates cannot pick those up. We're going to be trying to turn them in. He will get so. Furious D should be able to do the same, and we're so close. 9 more until 2ARC can start getting those lanes pushed back.
Well, we have 8 on 2ARC Traitor, and just kind of need to get a few more from any kind of creep wave at all. But so far, I mean, again, hands are tied. We have a lot of presence here mid, because that is where Cloud9 is posturing, and they're about to hit level 18 as well.
Oh, Tsukii getting possibly caught out here. A good entangling roots from Malfurion will keep him safe as well, but looks like Pannucci really trying to get aggressive. You're looking for a good place to judgment, start the engagement there, but so far not finding it.
So Maelstrom is winning with Lili. They haven't won yet, but they've definitely put up a really, really big early game advantage there with that Zero Tool, with the roaming. They've had more turn in, 65 gems now needed for them instead of the 60 there for 2ARC. We haven't had huge team fights, and that's kind of been to the benefit here of Maelstrom, because in these bigger team fights, any stun on top of Lili, and you're going to be looking for a bad time. But 2ARC at this point also haven't been able to force them either.
Yeah, they really haven't. It's been very difficult for them. They've been trying to look for a good place to throw down that judgment, but so, I mean, you don't want to do it on Johanna. That's not really the ideal target there. But now we do have Roots going down, and Lili is going to have to drop that Jug of 1,000 Cups. Will we see a Void Prison going down on 3 members of 2ARC? There goes the Maw as well on that, to that Archon. They want to try to get something done in the meantime. A Judgment will go down on Johanna after all into the Entangling Roots, and they will be able to take out that Warrior.
Well, so there's a lot of zone control going from both sides, but it does look like 2ARC will actually be favored at the end of this fight. You're not going to be catching that Tassadar. You might actually be able to catch up to DunkTrain, but at the same time, they're getting dangerously close to their own fortifications, so it doesn't really look like there's going to be too much more out of this scuffle. But Maelstrom losing out to Johanna, this could actually lead us into a boss.
Indeed, and you look how they are moving up there. They're going to start it before they get the turn-in. So there's the turn-in, and because we still see the boss is yellow, that means we have 2ARC engaging on it. But Maelstrom know this as well. There's still 21 seconds down until they will have Johanna, but they know that they really want to try to engage on it. Will they wait for her, or are they just going to go in for it?
Well, there's no Void Prison. There's no Cups either. It's going to come down to Kael'thas and his poke and his zone, but so far, it's working.
Ooh, it is indeed. Pannucci and Traitor are both so low, and now Tsukii and Furious D are caught out a little bit. In fact, we did lose Tyrael as well as Uther. Furious D now just trying to get out. Won't be able to do so either. The Flamestrike's going to take her out, and now we are going to have Maelstrom end up picking up the boss. I think we just saw why they call it the Throw Pit.
Yeah, the Throw Pit was absolutely real right there, Gillyweed. So something to note, though, for 2ARC, while they do have to deal with this red boss marching down the top lane, which, remember, there's a half hit point keep on the back of that one. It's going to die in a few swings. They also, 2ARC has the blue Web Weavers out on deck. Now, unfortunately, the top is already down and mid has just dropped there as well, but the bottom was able to pick up a fort by the end of it, and that's a good amount of experience that 2ARC really needs at this point, because they're dangerously close to a level 20 opponent.
Oh yeah, and they do not want to give too long of a window to Maelstrom to be able to push in and get all the lanes, maybe even get Web Weavers of their own while they don't have those Storm talents. Now, we do have them working on that boss. Zagara will be up in just a few seconds, but in the right side of the battleground, we have Maelstrom looking to pick up their bruisers and start putting more pressure toward their opponents.
All right, so bruisers will march down. I don't even think this guy's even going to get through that that shield. Nope, he will actually drop. All of 2ARC is now back to full power, all 5 team members there on the map. But, you know, Fan, 12 gems, going to put him in. That's not nearly enough for the 65 that the team does need, but every little bit will count at this point. And Maelstrom, again, they got level 20. If they can actually time out a big team fight in and around the area of another turn-in, that could be game right there.
That definitely could. They've already got an avenue open to the core from that top lane. And now we do have bruisers being picked up by 2ARC as well, and they're going to try to get out as safely as they can on the battleground and start getting some soak. Thankfully, because their lane is pushed on top, they do at least get the soak there, but it looks like Fan might be trying to get some sort of setup. They are rotating around. If he can get this this lane pushed, then they're going to force 2ARC to either have to defend and maybe get into an engagement or lose another keep.
Yeah, the bottom keep, half hit points. I think it's just really mid at this point that has any kind of big bastion of health. But nobody has any gates, and we already do got those catapults pushing down. Might be to the 2ARC favor, but ooh, Pannucci once more taking a heck of a hit.
Yeah, he was able to Eldrin away, but that just really shows the amount of damage being done by iDream on that Kael'thas. And in fact, we are going to see the Phoenix here to start zoning. So now the Giants are there. They're starting to throw their rocks onto the keep. All they have to do is keep them rather healthy in that
Boom.
Keep will go down.
That last rock was the rock that broke the keep's back at this point. But, you know, level 20, Maelstrom is still not hard engaging on any of this.
No, they don't. I mean, they realize, I think, that they don't need to overcommit. They are the ones who are in control of these lanes. They're the ones who don't really need to start any sort of crazy engagement near the structures that could potentially put them in a bad position. So instead, they're once again going to go clear their lanes. They can just watch the turn-in points. They know that they almost have a turn-in, and from there, they could definitely push in with those web weavers to win.
All right, so that's three more gems now going to go the way of Maelstrom. So at this point, I mean, it's still not quite enough. It's about 62 or so. There's another wave coming. And on the back of that, we should actually have enough. That should be the turn-in. The big question is, you know, it's been very passive. The Lili heals, I don't know if it's really just an issue of they don't have the confidence of it, or they just don't want to judge, they don't want to suffer a judgment into it to kind of ruin a team fight. But we've been really picking our battles at very, very slowly, very methodically. It's been kind of passive play for Maelstrom, which is kind of interesting. But, I mean, again, could it be the Lili? Could it be the team comp? The double healers are not something they're going to win against in a big, long, protracted battle. So they've kind of been avoiding it as well. Like, we have, what, nine takedowns in
It's like something like
20
eight
minutes
versus five. It's pretty small, but actually we also see Tuark not really choosing to engage, at least really picking their battles as well. Of course, we do see them. They've been down some in terms of talent tiers, which always means that you're going to play a little bit more passively, try to catch up there. But with somebody as strong of engage as Tyrael with that judgment, it's very interesting to see them, you know, playing pretty passively as well.
All right, so Boz is done. We're going to get back in. Everybody is ready. But it does feel like, Gilly, it's a lack of engage versus a lack of sustain. And it's almost like it's the opposite of an immovable object hitting an unstoppable force, because there's just nothing hitting each other.
That's indeed what is going on. And now we are back into the game. And we looks like they only need one more gem. Maelstrom really want to get this turn in. K1 Pro's trying, but also Tuark realize that this is it. They have to stop this turn-in. Pannucci getting very, very low and stunned from a possible Eldrin's Might. He will go down, and a Void Prison is going to lock down two more members. Tsukii taking a ton of damage already.
Yeah, but now Tsukii, he's going to be on the big retreat. Jaina is actually going to drop there off-camera as well. That's two takedowns for Maelstrom. That's going to be the gem turn-in there as well. And now, with a three-man defender disadvantage, Tuark very likely to be dropping their core, because two keeps already down. That's going to be catapults, web weavers, and an entire five-man team from Maelstrom coming into this. It's the worst thing in the world to lose out your tank just as he hits level 20.
It is indeed. They've got those Storm Talons, but they still have, for 40 seconds, both Jaina and then 30 seconds Tyrael down. Tsukii getting picked up by a Gravity Lapse will go down as well. And now we do see that Caffeine is going to be trying to just zone the rest of the members of Tuark so that they can throw all the damage that they've got left on the core. The shields are down. The Web Weavers are still pushing as well, but they're taking a whole bunch of damage. Can they do it here?
Well, Lili's actually going to drop, and King Caffeine actually a little bit lower, but still the core is ticking down. We got some catapults on it into the top, but Caffeine still is actually going to be okay. He took the Storm Shield on top of that. That's where you see that little shield coming from. But, you know, Tuark, can they actually hold it? That's a blink forward there from Furious D. He's really looking for red in that one. But would you believe that Tuark, you know, it's not 2%, but they will hold at 72.
That is still frightening for them. They've got to try to get these web weavers off of their middle keep as well. It's the only one left, but they also have to keep their core from taking any more damage as well. And that does mean that they're going to have to sacrifice the keep here in order to get rid of the rest of the web weavers first. But they have at least held Cloud9 Maelstrom from taking the game right here.
Now 72 down to 55 by the time that the dust settles. And as he said, the keep is now out. There's a boss left on the table. The Grave Golem into the top could easily be a way to end this out. We got some bruisers now to put up some counter pressure here mid. We're still waiting for Lili to come back into this game. Tuark is going to try to use every single second, I suppose, for the boss, or maybe they're just scouting it out. They don't actually have any interest themselves. But at the same time, do they have the gems? Because I highly doubt it.
I don't think they do as well. And this is very unfortunate for them because they really don't have the power here. They don't have any of their keeps left. So they really are, every last engagement, every single objective could be their last.
All right, Chubbs taking a little bit of poke back and forth. Remember, it's really hard to win in a sustained war against a Kael'thas because of that range, the little bit of damage, the burst itself. But with the double healers so far, Tuark are definitely holding. They have 55% of the core. One misstep could cost them this game.
It could indeed. And already we do see a good minion push on bottom, as we do have catapults there. So that means that Furious D has to go back. This is what catapults mean. You have to babysit that lane from now on, as it'll naturally push against you when you have one of your keeps down. In the meantime, talk about push. We have bruisers in the mid just being taken out that were from Maelstrom, and they're working on those bottom siege giants as well.
All right, so the Siege Giants will be adding a little bit of pressure. I mean, we had those bruisers in the mid. Looks like they've actually been cleaned up. Well, they're down to just the mage minion part of it. No, it's gone as well. So there's not a lot of pressure going back and forth. But is the plan here from both teams just to kind of soak a little bit, get more levels and more gems, and just try to time something off that? Because neither team is really moving forward against the other. Maelstrom is getting a little bit offensive here and trying to take out these bruisers, but the sandwich is actually starting to shape up.
Yeah, I thought maybe Maelstrom just wanted to try to get some pressure and then rotate up to the boss, but they have to be careful here and did have to back off of those bruisers. Two are doing desperately everything they can to protect the one objective they might be able to pick up here safely as their bruisers, but I don't even think they can take that safely at this point.
Yep, you see those stones being thrown, and there's the Judgment.
There it is indeed, with the Divine Storm immediately following that as well, but does not take anybody out. Everyone's still very healthy here for Maelstrom, and Traitorr on the opposite side is very, very low, even with that double sustain, as well as Tsukii, who will go down. So now we do have one member down. It looks like they are focusing on Caffeine. That's not who you necessarily want to be focusing, even though the Maelstrom did go down on the other members. So without that, they have lost their support. He will be back into the fight, though. He does have that redemption, so now they do still have all their members up, but they are fairly low thanks to that damage output from Kael'thas.
Yeah, quite a few heroics going back and forth. You can see now as well the boulders being thrown on top of the core, but it's not going to break that shield. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Well, all right, we're going to go right back to these bruisers, and that's kind of what started off that entire fight right there as well. But the Judgment into everything got defeated by the Blink. We are past the level 20, so the Bolt of the Storm is actually very real at this point. It's really hard to lock these guys down. We had the Divine Storm. The thing is that Furious D threw out that Maw. It was a great Maw. Three people landed in top of it. Great. Awesome. Fortunately, it was nowhere near anything relevant at the time. So, a lot of cooldowns now are going to be expended. And, well, Chubbs is a little far forward.
He is indeed, but fans still feeling fairly nervous about getting too far forward himself. So we are going to have Tuark still looking to possibly try to get a turn in, maybe stop the turn in here. They're really playing on the defensive here, Sean.
That flamethrower is just absolutely obnoxious. Just out of nowhere, Uther just gets lit up. Not a fun time to be up against a level 16 Kael'thas, especially now that he has that Bolt of the Storm. But, you know, K1 Pro, likely not to go down to this pressure.
No, he is the Tassadar. He's got that dimensional shift that helps him, but they're still going to stick on him anyway. He is slowed down, and now we have a Void Prison going down. Tsukii is going to drop the Divine Storm once again with the Judgment onto, I think it was Johanna, but in the meantime, Jaina is down. Pannucci is very low, very far forward as well, is going to continue the chase, but he has to make sure he's protecting his teammates as well. Shrink Ray going to go down on Tassadar. It is, looks like, only one drop so far from Tuark, but Maelstrom want to continue the pressure.
Well, Pannucci's kind of away from the rest of his team. He's already thrown down that Eldruin as well, and now he's on the wrong side of the line of scrimmage. He's going to be picked off probably in the back. Furious D is about to blow up there as well. Boom, there she goes with that Ignite. The Kael'thas, as I said, is just absolutely obnoxious. Got off a good Maw. We'll stop DunkTrain and iDream at least temporarily, but again, we're looking at a defender disadvantage for Tuark, and this is a 55% core.
Yeah, it is indeed. This will be game as Maelstrom is trying, or they're going to throw out at least the Phoenix to zone here, start working on that shield as well. Tsukii going after Fan, who's just running around the core, playing ring around the Rosie, throwing down the damage, and here is Lilia to start dropping the heals, keeping everyone very healthy. This will be it. Maelstrom will take game one in a very long game, back and forth at least in those engagements.
Yeah, a little bit protracted, but Cloud9 Maelstrom seal the deal, and they put up the first point on the board in their best of three for their debut match here for the July North American Open. You know, a little bit of technical difficulties going into that, so we didn't quite get to see the entire of it, but at the same time, Maelstrom didn't really look like they lacked control whatsoever.
No, they really kept control throughout the fight, and that really just goes to that Fan, who was able to do such a good job of making sure to pick off, start throwing damage on the right targets, as well as once they got the Kael'thas, oh man, that was so much damage that they could get at 16.
All right, so Kubi, what did you think of the match?
Game. That last fight, he was able to lock out so many members. That was Fan playing that hero. But actually, the part that I'm going to bring up with this replay is actually, I got two words for it. Throw pit.
Yep.
Okay. A lot of this comes down to this point up here. So I'm going to go ahead and pause it. And you guys can see that there are quite a few heroes bunched up right here. And it's all about zone control. So Maelstrom is looking to get up to this point. They want to try to contest this boss. We're going to see a Phoenix get thrown down here at this point. And, of course, this is being played by iDream. Let me see if I can draw this for you guys. Ooh. Right in there. So he's gonna rotate over here, and he wants to throw the flamethrower right about at this point. He's going to put the Phoenix in the part that I already mentioned, and this provides an insane amount of zone control. Basically, two archers left with decisions. Do we stay to try to continue to capture this? But they're too bunched up, so we're going to clear this. We're going to play this forward, and you can see, hold on, oh. We're going to try to advance that. Maybe it's not working for us. Oh, there we go. Awesome. Okay. Phoenix gets thrown out. That forces him out. You can see the flamethrower. And with the flank from K1 Pro, they were able to lock so many of the members out. But really what this comes down to is heroes getting taken out left and right, just taking too much damage from the Kael'thas. That flamethrower ignite combo that you guys were talking about is so, so strong.
It's just a really defining combo, especially as soon as you see a Kael'thas, you know instantly, at least here on the North American side, flamethrower ignite. Chain bomb, you don't really get to see that a lot. Pyroblast, every now and then, but the Phoenix, the chain bombs, level 16, so much zoning, so much damage, it's really frustrating sometimes when you're on the losing side of that.
It is indeed, and because they were able to use that combination to pick up that first game, we will have them taking a 1-0 lead in this best of three, but 2ARC still do have the potential to bring it back for sure.
Oh, absolutely. 2ARC is definitely known for their eccentric drafting, and well, maybe it was a little bit normal this round. Perhaps they have something else up their sleeve. Cognitive cannot go out with the wild card on this one, I don't think, but you never know. The day is still young, and guys, you know, we're going to be here. You're hopefully going to be joining us, but as well, if you get bored, you know, go over to heroesofthestorm.com, download the game yourself, see what we're talking about, see why we're so happy to be here to see these teams and these plays and why we get excited. Perhaps you'll get excited with us too. When we come back, it will be game number two of this game series, Cloud9 Maelstrom and 2ARC. Stay tuned.
If I'm not playing Heroes of the Storm, I'm either spending time with my family or trying to stay in shape so I can perform better inside the game.
I like collecting Funko Pop action figures, I like hiking, and I also really like going jogging.
I'm taking a class right now at a community college in the morning.
Right now my life is pretty much getting better Heroes of the Storm, getting better at the game, and trying to make a name for myself and my teammates.
I love all the Blizzard games, so I play StarCraft, WoW, Hearthstone.
Before moving to the house, I used to work a day job at Google. My family at first wasn't too supportive. They're not quite sure, like, oh, you have a nice job, you can just work your 9-to-5. They weren't even like really aware that this was, so they're just really confused when I started talking to them about this at first. They're like, video games? Getting paid? What? No way.
I currently work in San Francisco as a research data analyst.
I love the outdoors, I love to kayak.
What do I do outside of Heroes of the Storm? That's a damn good question.
Down to this Stormwind champion versus Ogre Brute.
I'm feeling really good about Stormwind here.
Whoa!
Am I seeing this right?
Could be a scare tactic, Bob. Could be nerves.
Now, I don't think scare tactics work with ogres.
You know from experience.
Okay, well, let's not get into my personal life.
Hold that thought. Looks like we have a substitution. It's Tinkmaster Overspark.
This guy's a very technical player. His game's about nuance, precision.
Whoa! That's Hearthstone.
Play free on your phone or PC.
Rate the T for T.
To be the first Hellscream. You were destined to be my greatest champion. And instead, you chose this. You have no vision. Behold, what a true seat of power demands. A citadel of hellish fire worthy of my masters. A monument to entomb the souls of all who would dare to defy us.
They will defy you. I have seen their forces in battle. They are fearless. It does not matter what vile creatures you summon to the battle. They will persevere. Their resolve is unbreaking. They will come. They will fight. And they will wash their blades of your blood in victory.
Fight if you must, Hellscream. It is no matter. In the end, we all serve the Legion.
We are not afraid to try new things or approach the game from a different angle.
Being open and not set on specific standards or ways is one of our strengths.
You know, not the typical decisions you'll see, especially when it comes to drafting heroes and our team compositions.
A lot of teams are always about support warrior 3 DPS. You know, we started bringing out different things. You know, we were like, well, why don't we just run tankless comps? Why don't we just do this and run, you know, a specific killer with these tankless comps and then, you know, build around that.
When it comes down to the actual tournament and the competition, that's when we really give it our best.
I think the team's strength is just, it feels like everybody's on the same page all the time. That synergy is just something that we bring to the table that a lot of the other teams need to work on. We don't really need to communicate what the exact game plan is, basically in-game body language, if that makes sense.
Just at a mechanical level, just being able to control your hero to the very best of your ability, we have a very strong advantage over every other team in terms of that. We have five players who are all very, very good mechanically at this game.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, here to the July North American Open, as we are here with match number 4. We'll be jumping into game number 2 in just a little bit here between Cloud9, Maelstrom, and Tuark. And as you can see, already these teams, you know, duking it out head-to-head. It's quite the matches going forward. I'm Forgo Jester. With me here is going to be Gillyweed, and once more, Mr. Kubi off to the side. What'd you guys think of that game?
Well, we saw in that video Maelstrom talking about the control, the synergy that they have together, and we definitely got to see that in that last game. The synergy between the Kael'thas, the Zeratul as well, they had so much damage, and especially the later the game got, the scarier that they were.
Absolutely.
Yeah, Gilly, good point. I will say, yes, stalling out was the name of the game, I think, for Cloud9 and Maelstrom in that composition. Once they got to 16, we talked about it before, but Kael'thas gets so strong at that level when you pair that up with good VPs from Fan. iDream was just able to get in and do his work, and everyone else just seemed to be synergizing so much better for Maelstrom in the late game. And I think if they continue to carry that type of momentum forward, they'll have finding themselves pretty well off in this series.
All right, so to our extent that they're going to be bringing their best, let's hope that they still have that best ready to go here for game number 2, because down 1-0, this could be actually their entry into that lower bracket. But, you know, who was some of the MVPs of that match? Well, we saw quite a few players going back and forth, but there's one that we're actually going to throw a spotlight to. And, you know, it's just these guys, they did really good work in the match here. We had a little bit of technical difficulty there in the mid, but by the end of it, it just looked like everybody had exemplary play. And it doesn't actually look like we're going to do the spotlight. So
I think we're going to check out Pannucci. So we'll see one of the members of Tuark and see if they can bring it back in this series. So looking at Pannucci, he is playing for Tuark and loves to play that Tyrael like we saw in the last game. He also plays a very mean Kerrigan as well. So these very aggressive, very great heroes at being able to engage, and is actually a nationally ranked chess player at that, guys.
Well, I mean, Pannucci, he seems like a smart guy. I've definitely played with him. He had some really good competitions. I'd like to think I'm pretty good at chess, but national ranked, yeah, I think I'll take a pass. I think
got
I'll take
that,
a pass.
That strategy on lock. So we're also going to take a look at one of the members of Cloud9 Maelstrom. You know, they had a lot of really good players out and about. I could probably name any of them at this point that, you know, stood out in that last match. We're going to take a look at DunkTrain, Derek Arabian. He has been on the team for some time now, at least, you know, just after BlizzCon. So these guys have been together for a while. He got the 5th place Blizzard Streamer Award for the most educational Heroes of the Storm streamer. And I can say that I have tuned into his stream many times, and I can agree wholeheartedly with that.
I remember when we were doing the race to 40s back in the Alpha days, and he was one of those big leading streams. Definitely a well-deserved reward, and you know, I'm glad you guys are here. You're my rocks, because there was no way I was going to be able to do that with that camera angle. Absolutely. All right, so Heroes of the Storm, guys, we're going to be jumping into the draft, but remember, the Heroes of the Storm North America Road to BlizzCons is brought to you by our official hardware partners of Gigabyte and NVIDIA. We thank you for your sponsorship and your generosity so that we can do events like this. Couldn't have done it without you, and now we are ready. What are we about to see here? Game number 2, Gilly.
Well, first of all, we will be on the Garden of Terror, the terrifying garden. And I think this is the first time that we're seeing it today,
Not only the first time we're seeing it today. We didn't see this map at all in the June Open. So this is the first time for these competitive
qualifier events. Wow.
This is the first time we are seeing Garden of Terror.
So two arc, Garden of Terror. Something comes to mind, Gilly. Vikings.
Indeed they do. We've seen a little bit of a less surgence, I guess, the opposite of a resurgence for them. But one place we still see them a lot is on the Garden of Terror. Now, apparently this is not something that the teams are so concerned about that they're going to ban them out. Instead, we're going to see bans on the Protoss Brethren, Tassadar on one side and Zeratul on the other.
Can't let Cloud9 have either of them, I suppose. They did really good game number one.
So Tuark is going to scoop up the Jaina as the first pick. Cloud9 Maelstrom battling back with an early Uther pick. And considering that they did not ban out any of the other supports early on, I think this is just we feel comfortable in this. Maybe we're looking to try to run a melee assassin, maybe Butcher, Kerrigan, who knows. Not really sort of something that defines Maelstrom's style, but you know, just to keep that in mind for the rest of the draft.
Yeah, especially with that early Uther pickup, because you can always show that divine shield that people like to pick up along with a melee assassin. Mm-hmm. So showing that early kind of gives reference to that. They also are going to grab Kael'thas, so we're going to once again see one of the sorcerers on one side and one of them on the other.
All right, so, you know, we talked a little bit about the Uther. Uther is actually a first pick strategy for Tuark. I've seen this actually, because I did the coverage of the Open. Mm-hmm. They do this a lot, and, you know, Uther, he's a great hero, but Chubbs adores him. You know, we talk a lot about Tempo Storm adoring Rhaegar, but this is 100% the preference when it comes to Tuark. And again, you know, Divine Shield, Divine Storm. We've seen both. We've seen full invulnerability comps using the Divine Shield and the Sanctification, the Holy Light, the Radiance. I mean, the stuns that he brings, the crowd control. Overall, he is the big number one support pick here for Tuark. So, that being said, it makes more sense that actually Tuark first picked it.
Hello. Just swap that around for you guys. No worries. So now we have the picks and bans lined up in the right order for you. So Uther, Kael'thas still. I retain that my analysis is that they are looking to grab a melee warrior or melee assassin.
And Tuark, I think, fits into that.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I think we might be even seeing a Kerrigan there for that Pannucci, but will we see the no warrior composition along with that?
Oh, that would be a treat, wouldn't it, Gilly?
It would indeed.
Cloud9 Maelstrom, though, they will take their Rhaegar and Tyrande because they did actually have the first pick, which means that they get their second round before the bans, and already you can see Mirrodin's on the chop block.
I like the Mirrodin ban. I think that the combination between Jaina, Tyrande, and Mirrodin is very strong. Teams have proven many times that it is a very powerful and scary combination to go up against. So Tuark looking to take that away from Maelstrom. Maelstrom follows this up with a Zagara ban.
So no information control. You can't put those creep tumors in the bushes. You're not going to have that laning presence of a Zagara. Just left your own devices. Not a bad ban whatsoever.
No, not at all. Now, Tuark have picked up their next hero. It won't be a Zero Warrior composition this time as they grabbed Johanna, but now they have limited the tanks there, the warriors that Maelstrom can pick out, and they've grabbed those lost Vikings on top of it.
So, Gooby, remind me, is this the second time we've seen Vikings today? Or is this the first?
No, I believe this is the first time we have seen the Vikings. Not a hero that gets picked up too much in the most recent patch. mainly just because of some of the changes. And maybe people aren't uncomfortable with it. They just, you know, don't feel as though they're quite as strong as they used to be. But still, there's a good argument that on Garden of Terror, this hero, or heroes, if we will, are still quite good. So I suppose the jury's still out on that.
Two arcs going for the plus two advantage for a 7-on-5. But Cloud9 Maelstrom, they will finish it off. Arthas once more. And the Butcher, of course, he was still on the table through that Tyranda, and Cloud9 Maelstrom is looking like a very aggressive comp killer.
That is incredibly scary. They've got the Howling Blast from Arthas to be able to lock somebody down. The Butcher can Ruthless Onslaught in, and then immediately follow that up with the Lunar Flare from Tyranda. Stunlocked for days, even Jaina to be able to throw down a ton of abilities to slow, but what is this? We must look at Rainer, Sean.
All right, so if we throw Rainer up onto the screen, this is he's a big core player in StarCraft, but when it comes to Heroes of the Storm, he's never really held a spotlight, Kubi.
Mm. Yeah, and it's got a lot to do with... Well, no, that's not entirely true, actually. In the very, very early of the alpha, if you recall correctly, his auto attack builds were quite strong. He's gone through a lot of changes and iterations at this point, but a lot of it has to come down to the penetrating round. And I guess there's a lot of maybe anti-synergies, if you want to call it that. He's very, very strong when it comes down to 1v1ing, especially if you go for that penetrating round build. He can really dish out a lot of damage to a single target. He has some good heroics that help in team fights, but otherwise, when it comes down to it, it's been tricky for teams to try to find a place for Rainer to fit in. Maybe Tuark knows something that we don't, and they're looking to prove us wrong.
Well, the rumor mill actually supports Rainer as an anti-Butcher hero. Because the Butcher would come in, and then you penetrating around in his face, and he goes backwards.
Sure.
So that way you can't actually use the brand, you can't lifesteal.
Yeah, disengage, kind of. Yep.
Yeah, and if you're even late on your Furnace Blast, I mean, it's not going to hit anyone. But we'll have to see if that actually does come to pass. Ms. Gilly, I believe, actually, we're going to tell everyone a little bit about the Garden of Terror, if you could be so kind.
I would love to. Guys, we will be on Garden of Terror, and here we are looking at a video about it. It's going to be a three-lane battleground, a very large one at that, with a lot of different mercenary camps. This map does move from day into a night cycle, and when it's at night, there's actually less vision. So vision is definitely something that teams like to prioritize here with somebody like a Zagara, like we see here. Now, during the night phase, we will have camps that spawn, and when you take them down, you're able to collect seeds. Collect 100 seeds, and your Garden Terror will grow in your base. And once you can put on the Garden Terror suit, you become a sieging machine, dealing so much damage to structure, especially with that potted plant like we see there in the video.
So you talked about putting on the suit. You know, kind of reminds me a little bit of Iron Man. Maybe I just saw the Avengers. But it sounds like, you know, the suit is something that the player can do. And who do we have more players on Tuark? It's 7 versus 5. And those Vikings,
yeah.
Kubi, like, what can they do that's so special?
That is really what made the Vikings so strong on this map in previous iterations. If you have the 3 soak, not only that, because it's a large map and you can really maximize that soak, but you can put one of the Vikings in the Garden Terror to push, continue to soak the other lanes, and have a scary, scary roaming presence across the map. And I think that's really the argument for Tuark's side as to why they picked up the Vikings in the first place.
It's definitely the leading theory. As you said, you know, a little bit of a nerf going into them.
Yeah.
Not as survivable as they used to be, but they're still physical bodies, and physical bodies put on the suit.
Mm-hmm.
They do indeed. And whether or not we'll have them putting in, I think we'll probably see a Viking in there. And as Kubi mentioned, then on top of that, with the push, the passive lane soak, they really can have the freedom to move around with the rest of their heroes. But everyone else on the opposing team, on Maelstrom, they have to choose between soaking or trying to defend versus that terror.
And it's always a little bit of a tougher choice. You know, do you defend against theirs? Do you push with yours? Once again, though, something that really kind of sparks an idea, there's no Sylvanas again.
Yeah, no Sylvanas.
What happened to Sylvanas today?
Like, some of
this
the more,
entire weekend.
Some of the more aggressive compositions that we've been seeing picked up by some of these teams, just seems like Sylvanas goes a little bit by the wayside, especially when like Butcher, Tyranda are present. It's like we need to prioritize getting this combination all the support it needs and making sure they have the proper warrior damage to follow up on this. And it kind of seems like if that's going to be the name of the game for the team, she gets pushed aside. So definitely a hero that has been seeing a little bit less play, but still very impactful on certain battlegrounds and certain compositions.
All right, so not only have we seen, you know, double, triple melee comps, we've seen a lack of Sylvanas, now the Vikings coming into it here as well. I mean, it is Tuark. We have been saying the eccentric drafts coming in. I think they're the only team that still runs Vikings on the Garden.
Is that really so? I mean, they're the only ones to bring in, I think, Tyrael as well. So they really are showing us some of that crazy, interesting picks, prioritization that they like prioritizing some of those heroes that other teams aren't really liking as much or not really prioritizing themselves.
All right, so guys, we are just kind of waiting around here for the confirmation that the game is good to go, but we do actually know who is going to play on which side. So off to the races, it is going to be Tuark, Tsukii, Traitorr, Pannucci, Furious D, and Chubbs. But Chubbs, again, on that Uther. Furious D, the captain on the Kael'thas, you know, said he's, these guys are really smart, really good at various, you know, mathematics. They got chess. I mean, yep. These guys are strategy masters. But I want to talk about Tsukii on Raynor. I want to talk about Traitorr on the Lost Vikings. Pannucci on the Johanna, he is the warrior player. But, you know, Traitorr on the Vikings.
I know. Yeah, he seems to be sort of the flex player for Tuark in that sense to play those maybe those specialist roles that require maybe a little more finesse. And he's done quite well even before the Vikings saw some changes. So no surprise to see that he's going to be the player that will jump into that role.
Yeah, and Tsukii on Raynor, you know, Tsukii likes to favor some of these assassins that we don't see as much. Like, we see him a lot on Falstaff.
Yes.
And yeah. Now we're seeing him on Raynor.
Oh, man. So, all right. So, you know, we'll have to wish these guys luck, but their opponents, they're up 1-0 in this game series, if you recall, ladies and gentlemen. And the number two seed, nonetheless, iDream playing Jaina. That's just enough to kind of give me the shakes right there. DunkTrain on the Rhaegar, Keiwan Pro on the Tyrande. We got KingCaffeine, just ridiculously good warrior on Arthas, who is, again, you know, on the rise, and Fan on the Butcher. I'm getting excited about that.
Oh, I am so pumped. I haven't really seen too much of Fan on the Butcher, but we know how amazingly scary he is on those melee assassins.
Yeah, he does sort of gravitate towards that role on the team, and the couple games that I've seen of Maelstrom where Fan is on the Butcher, it is quite terrifying, aptly so, and I'm excited to see what he's able to bring to Tuark in this game, but more importantly, the Lost Vikings and Raynor is going to prove to be something quite interesting. I think we have the game ready to go, so we're going to hop on into that, guys. This is game two between Cloud9 Maelstrom and Tuark.
Thank you so much, Kubi. We'll see you afterwards for some of your expert analysis as we get into it. But it is going to be Tuark on the left-hand side. Cloud9 Maelstrom, as you see, kind of doing the Dunkin' Roland Donut there from DunkTrain on the Rhaegar. They will represent a red. And getting into this back and forth, you know, you can do a lot of things with Vikings, Gilly. What would you expect to see as the gates are about to fall?
So I think what we'll probably see is them, it looks like, separating out into each of the lanes. They can put one in each lane, and we might even see them, because of that, rotating around with some of their other heroes. They could maybe do something with Uther and Kael'thas, or Kael'thas and Johanna, try to pick up some of those early takedowns. But because of that, it does mean that the Vikings are a little bit squishier. They're a little bit easier to take down. So if Traitorr isn't careful, if they get too far out of position, then Maelstrom can take down one of them, and all of a sudden they don't have someone soaking in that lane.
And that is definitely a big point to think about, because the Vikings, you know, as we have mentioned a few times, when the Butcher was introduced, there was massive changes to the hero, and he's not quite as versatile as he used to be. But Tuark, the only other time I've seen them run Vikings here on Garden was actually in the last weekend's June Open qualifiers, and they did this exact strategy. They put one in every single lane. Maelstrom doesn't care for it, as you can tell. They will get that first takedown very quickly. But if I had to guess, Tuark is actually running the Viking Bribery, and that's why they're split up.
Oh yes, indeed. They're going to be looking to pick up those region globes. They're also going to be looking to get stacks for that bribery as well. And Maelstrom are going to do their best to try to rotate around and either take out one of them, or even better, take out a hero like Tsukii here, as immediately he just gets melted. Even ChubbsZ now is in so much danger. Will they be able to pick him up? They will indeed.
I've never ever thought of calling him ChubbsZ. I've never thought of that, but I'm 100% doing it now.
It just makes sense. They've got like Furious D, Pannucci, ChubbsZ, Tsukii.
Why have I never thought of that?
It's just adorable.
All right, Eric is also going to take some time out to think about what he was doing there in the mid lane. But so far, going back and forth, every Viking, every single three of them at this point, I suppose, is only worth a quarter of a kill worth of experience. So going back and forth, it's not the end of the world. The bigger problem is that, as you said a little bit earlier, the lack of soak that might result because of that now missing body.
Yeah, the nice thing would be if they could just have those Vikings each in lane and then be able to move around and pick up as many seeds as possible with the rest of their heroes. And if Maelstrom would just leave all the Vikings alone, that would be very nice. Thank you very much. But Maelstrom is not really doing that. They're making sure to rotate around, and anytime they see a Viking maybe a little bit too far forward, they grab him. Now Maelstrom are looking to even maybe contest some of these seeds, and we'll pick up a bunch of them there, enough to be able to pick up their not only a takedown on Kael'thas, but their Garden Terror as well.
Oh man, Pannucci's in a bad spot. You cannot run away from Arthas these days. it's really hard, and here comes a big unstoppable butcher on top of it as well. The follow-up stun with the Tyranda, and Olaf apparently has collateral somewhere else. It is actually a bloodbath at this point. 5 takedowns, nil, and 2 of those 3 Vikings taking a dirt nap.
Oh yeah, for sure. They do. They will be back into action fairly soon, but now we're seeing some pings on some mercenary camps. So like when we saw when the turn-ins happened on Tomb of the Spider Queen, once a Garden Terror is picked up, you can't get any of these mercenary camps. They go away until the Garden Terror is gone. So a really great control by Maelstrom to go ahead and start taking out one of these camps and then go get their Garden Terror. That means there's going to be a push in one lane and a push in another one. And if they rotate some heroes around, they could even do a push in 3 different lanes.
So not only do we have the Terror now spawned here for Maelstrom, looks like Fan is actually going to be in that pilot seat. A little bit of a skirmish there into the mid, but at the same time, level 7 about to hit here as well. That's a big advantage, and unfortunately, advantage is what Eric needs to dodge that one. Balog, too, somewhere else. These Vikings are definitely getting lost.
These poor Vikings, indeed, and a huge push with these Siege Giants by Maelstrom. So they're going to choose to have a split push here, looking to take down as many towers as possible, as many structures as they can, so that they can continue this experience lead that they've gained so far, maybe even get their heroics before 2 arc.
So a big strategy with those Vikings is, as I mentioned before, Viking bribery. You can't bribe anything that's not there. This early Terror really working out to Maelstrom. Look at these body blocks there as well. Pannucci just trying to go home, and these guys are bullying him around.
Johanna is not an easy hero to take down by any means, and a great, like you said, body blocks. And now a huge Blizzard on Chubbs as well, and will help take down that Uther. Now with the big push with those 2 takedowns, the experience lead is just increasing. But Vikings are still in lane. Bottom lane, pretty much been soaking this entire time, so it's not so terrible for them.
Yeah, we'll see what iDream has to say about that one. There's no jump, and there's no invulnerabilities for Olaf here at level 7 anymore. That is now a level 13 talent. So he is going to go down to the curbside. He's going to take a little bit of a dirt nap, and at the same time, again, like, we're pushing top, we're pushing mid, we're level 9, nearly level 10. Those heroics are just on the horizon, Gilly.
Oh man, a huge cleanse went down on that Arthas to keep him safe from the Condemn. That is a great job by that Dunk Train. Cleanse, not often something that you get to see in those really big team fights, but they're always somehow keeping somebody alive, keeping somebody safe from a big CC, and so it was really neat to see it. But like you mentioned, we almost have heroic abilities now. Both teams are choosing to murk up. They're going to get the Vikings right back out in the battle. They'll last for hopefully a little while, but you never know, as Maelstrom has kind of been on a Viking hunt all of this game.
Yeah, and the lack of those bodies, the lack of that soak, and the lack of the stacks coming up from the Viking bribery, this is a really, really late bribe situation coming up for Traitorr. But the last time I saw him, he was able to pick up a bribe in a minute 30. It's now 5:30, and he has quite a few takedowns to his name. So that has really been affecting his stacks, his soak, and that's why we're 2 levels behind. If there's anything you ever want to avoid with Vikings, it's getting behind early, because it's really hard to crawl out of that.
Well, Tsukii is on the chase. The penetrating round went down, and a great gravity lapse is going to help them pick up the Butcher, even with the Furnace Blast. But that's all of the members, I do believe, of 2 Arc. So these Vikings have to be careful. Traitorr is going to go down, and once again, no lane soak in mid. They're going to have to rotate around, but see, seeds are up, Sean.
Yeah, and the seeds are going to try to demand the attention here of 2 Arc. Well, they are going to find Caffeine, and well, the body blocks are good enough. Arthas isn't going anywhere, and just getting pushed back by the penetrating round there from Tsukii. It is going to be enough. Here comes the rest of the claps. We do have heroics, though, for 2 Arc.
Oh, and this is a perfect place for Starfall there, and Kael'thas will be eliminated after dropping that Phoenix. Rainer is going to go down as well. That was a perfect place for an engagement for Maelstrom. They're even going to be able to, they will lose their Tyranda, though, so a good pickup at least there from 2 Arc in the mitigating that a bit. But Maelstrom, they have the first Terror, and they're already over 50 seeds into the next one.
Yeah, 50 compared to the 70. So that's 150 actually compared to the 70 at this point. But you know, if this guy does go down, that's going to be enough seeds to power up the next suit here for Maelstrom. They did just hit level 12 there as well. Very soon, they will hit that 13 mark with that talent tier advantage. And well, KingCaffeine has no time for Traitorr, but Traitorr as a scout, there's the bribe. You can see it off to the side. And finally, at 7 minutes, we get our first bribe out. It's been a rough game for Traitorr.
That was a great sort of juke there on that Arthas. He probably knew what was coming in, but maybe didn't realize or got a little bit distracted, and Traitorr was still able to pick those up right in his face. Unfortunately, he will take snow to his face and will go down.
Yeah, Eric, I mean, it felt very cat and mouse. It's like, oh, it's the cat there. All right, we're good. And got the cheese. But then, of course, the cat's neighbor came and beat him up. So, Yeah, don't know where that analogy was going. Either way, Maelstrom and Tuart are going back and forth. Again, you're looking at that level 13 advantage, and another Terror has already spawned. It's probably Fan in it, because I don't see him here on the board, and he's going to be marching down. In fact, looks like he's coming to the team fight with it.
Well, yeah, that's one of the great things you can do when getting such an early Terror and there's still seeds up, is he's basically pushed Tuart away from getting the rest of these seeds. So Tuart still has yet to get a Garden Terror in this game. They would love to be able to throw a Viking in there and keep pushing, but they can't even do that. They're even going to lose Baylog, and now level 13 talents have been picked up for Maelstrom.
Now, there has been something in these last few, quote, team fights, you know, going back and forth. Cloud9 Maelstrom is starting to Deathball clump up, and oh, that is going to hurt.
Oh, yes, indeed. The Starfall goes down, and so many members are being hit as the Divine Shield has to go down on Kael'thas. But how is he going to get out of that situation? So many good body blocks will ensure that both he and Uther are going to go down. Raynor is there, too. Pannucci, the only one left, trying to get away, and does get hit by that Spore Queen's Curse, trying desperately to maybe just lead these members away from the base. Oof. But she will go down as well.
All right, so you know, the counterpoint was Cloud9 Maelstrom is starting to Deathball. They're getting together, and even though they haven't taken down the Vikings are very tenacious. You can already see bottom lane pushing in. Top lane is, again, resuming to push in. At the before that fight, we were actually level 12 to 12. We had patched up that level difference, and that's a big thing to the Vikings. But when you lose four and a few little more heroes like that, of course, you know, now we see it shoot up. Level 13, level 15 now on the horizon. We're almost into the sweet spot for Cloud9 Maelstrom.
Yes, indeed. That sweet spot being having their 16 talent to the 13 of your opponents so that you have plenty of time to get a lot of presence out on the battleground as well. And here
going
comes the ruthless onslaught onto that poor Olaf. But I wanted to mention that not only with these fights have we seen the Vikings pushing in on lane, which is good by them, exactly what we need to do, but because of that, we have basically a constant 4v5 battles for Tuark.
Yep, and at one point we actually swapped out the idea of having everybody in lanes, and we just kind of left the Vikings to do their soaking and Tuark. For a four-man death ball, and that's how they got a few of their takedowns, and that's how they were able to get a few of their seeds. Unfortunately, four still does not beat five, especially when you're about to be a talent tier down, and Maelstrom is still very much in control of this map.
Yeah, it's been a great job by Maelstrom making sure that they are still kind of grouping up, not really spreading out too much, except maybe to pick up some seeds when they know they're very safe on the battleground. Like at this point, when they are about to get their 16, they can be aggressive, but look, we see them all together, and that's because they know they have strength in numbers. As long as those Vikings are spread out, they are going to have the advantage for any sort of big team fight.
Yep, Traitor's just kind of looking around. Another bribe coming in 3 minutes later. Still, I was about to ask, have we actually seen another bribe? Well, you know, the soaking has just not really rewarded us enough for that, but still, I mean, taking out that, we got Merc Pressure top, we got it mid. Cloud9 is okay with that, as it seems.
They are indeed. They've got some of these very aggressive Merc cams of their own. They're working on this bottom fort. They have already had a keep down. This is a very early keep down as well, which just means, of course, catapults have been pushing in the entire time, and you can see that. That bottom lane very, very pushed toward the base of Tuark.
Now, for the, those of you at home that want to actually maybe try a Viking comp at level 4, go for It's a Sabotage on Eric. That's why Eric is way up into that top lane pushing that keep. Does extra structure damage, does extra ammo burning as well, just like a demolitionist used to do in the days of old. Not that we really get to see that talent a lot these days, but I also noticed we've recalled the Vikings. They're now as 3 as well. Could we finally see a boat?
We might indeed. The Syndragosa, though, is going to go down, so we'll at least see a dragon as this first tower is going to be taken out. The next one should follow. Pannucci trying to get in. There are two of the Vikings left as Eric has gone down. Olaf will follow. And I'm not really sure where those Vikings were coming in at, but we definitely, I don't think, had the boat there.
I saw no boat. I'm a little confused why we didn't see a boat. And now I'm a little confused to see if we actually have play again, but I haven't seen that go down here either. Oh! It's the one-man boat.
a little
late, Traitor. A little late.
Well, at least a one-man boat is better than a no boat, probably. We do at least have 16 talents coming in almost for Tuark, so they're going to have a good window of opportunity, at least being on the same level as their opponents in terms of talents. But unfortunately, that does mean that they've got only about a couple of levels before their opponents will be picking up those Storm talents. They're going to use that time to get back on the battleground, make sure to get seeds. They really want to be able to pick up a Garden Terror this time.
All right, so 98, 90, there we go. 100, that's the magic number. Finally, we are going to have, well, if I have to guess, Eric, going to be piloting that suit. But this is the third Terror for Maelstrom. They got this level advantage. KingCaffeine actually could be in some big trouble. Whoa, that was close.
A fantastic Ancestral Heal is going to bring him right back up to speed. And now Jaina getting chased by those Vikings who are going to be able to jump right back out. They're all right.
Right into KingCaffeine.
Yeah, right. It's from one frost person into another. It's kind of an opposite of from out of the frying pan and into the fire. But there we do have a Garden Terror going. It looks like it wasn't Eric. It might have been Olaf, I guess, in it. It was indeed.
All right, so Olaf's in it. That's why we didn't really get that boat. Here comes the Sindragosa as well. Furious Deed, nowhere to go. Takes one slap and another. He is going to fall as Fan takes him down for a little bit of a dirt nav. And now Raynor into the back. The Adrenaline Rush looks like it's not going to get a huge amount of value, but they do get off that invulnerability. Two heroes now going to be taken out here for Cloud9 Maelstrom as they continue on with this push. There's the Adrenaline Rush from Tsukii. Is able to activate it. And now Fan is forced to retreat because he is going to be facing up against a really really bad situation as Tuark is continuing to chase him down, and Fan himself, no real escapes unless you're going to be charging someone. Unfortunately, he cannot charge the DunkTrain, and DunkTrain will just watch from afar as the rest of his team crumbles.
There goes the Butcher as well. Caffeine is going to go back. That Arthas, of course, can be very mana intensive, so needs to get back out into the fight. And what will we see Tuark do? It looks like they're going to choose to push toward the bottom fort. What do you think about this decision here?
Well, he was already into the bottom. We got 30 seconds left on him, quite a few hit points, and there's no one left to really contest him. So if the rest of the team goes top, that's probably going to be where Cloud9 Maelstrom will orient, because this is just a fort. It's a 13-minute fort. It's the only it's the second one to go down. This Terror is likely not to get a keep. It might get the gate at best, but the bigger thing for Maelstrom is to try to stop what's happening here. It's not quite, I think, going to be that Terror, although it's going to be very close, but they do need to stop out those seeds rather than stop out the Terror.
The flower is still open. It is a possibility.
Man,
that's
gonna be
kind
close.
Of the dream if you can get two in a row. 101! They do get another Garden Terror. Unfortunately, they are going to lose. Yeah, Olaf.
So it was actually Olaf into that, not Eric. The only reason I would say Eric is because he's a bit faster. You can actually zoom, zoom, zoom with him. But also, if you have to go down with the ship, get off some of that structural damage. With that, it's a sabotage at level 4. Maelstrom means business here, though.
Oh, there's the Sindragosa into the Furnace Blast. Yeah, they are not happy about those seeds. They are going to take out Uther. And because they aren't level 20 yet, they don't have that redemption. So we will be looking at Uther down for a while. Looks like 51 seconds. And Maelstrom possibly going to be looking for a push here. It looks like for now they are going to try to get some of those mercenary camps started before their opponents pick up that next Garden Terror.
So this isn't a terrible spot for Tuark. Sure, they're still on the defensive. Sure, they have one keep down. They still actually have the top fort there as well. So even with when these mercs do pop up, they're not going to get like huge keep value. They might just take out a fort, and you know it's going to be arguable if that will be the level 20. But because we're waiting for this Terror, it's not spawning yet. We're kind of waiting for the death timers to wind down. You know, Uther, he was at 45, now he's at 20, so he's going to come back into the fray fairly soon. At the same time, the rest of his team was off doing mercenaries. You see now at least one, if not two. Yep, we definitely have two mercenary camps ready to go here for Tuark as well.
Yeah, they're going to offer a nice counter push, especially in that middle lane where they don't have a keep. But up in the top, that's kind of a free push there for those bruisers. And it looks like Tuark are going to be more content to try to protect this Garden Terror, get some serious work done with it, as it will be a time when they don't have a Terror. Unfortunately, they've just lost Raynor. Now a Divine Shield has to go down to keep Kael'thas alive. Chubbs will be able to throw down some stuns, try to keep these other members off of him. But will we lose him because of that? They are looking to take him out. If they can pick up level 20, though, they can't get the redemption, and now he'll be back in the fight.
He's not going to exactly go down again. Nobody's actually chasing him, but Pannucci is looking unstoppable. Here comes Chubbs to the rescue, perhaps. He comes back into corporal form, and he will get off that heal on top of Pannucci, and this will actually be the end of that scuffle. All this time, though, Traitorr has been pushing out. You see the flower plants going down into the back, and will this actually be a keep? There's no one defending at this point. Well, unfortunately, Balog looks like he'll pay the price. But could we actually get a keep on this?
Well, that's kind of the problem with having the Vikings is you kind of sacrifice checking on the other ones in order to make sure you're running that Terror. But oh, the Sindragosa is huge. Immediately melts down Kael'thas. Indestructible has to come proc for Johanna. She's going to try to get away. Meanwhile, Chubbs is in a lot of trouble as another stun will come out. He did look to avoid it there as well, though. So it's going to be okay.
15 seconds left on the Terror. Not a lot of hit points there on it either, but he did get that keep. Unfortunately, the rest of the team of Cloud9 Maelstrom, they are going to be looking at no defenders at this point. Could easily just go straight for that core. Well, okay, I say that, but of course, Uther, he's actually still ticking. And Raynor has now respawned. It has taken so long for Maelstrom actually to get into the base that since he was the first one to go down, he's actually now back into the fray. But still, is this the endgame situation for Maelstrom?
Well, it looks like Maelstrom don't believe so. They're going to just take down this keep as well, but it kind of puts them in a weird position. They had to work down the gate at the same time to make sure they could get out, and actually Arthas won't be able to get out. A ton of damage coming out from the boat, and it is chasing down Fan, who will be able to escape from it as well. Now, we do have both teams, of course, with Storm Talents, and it looks like for a while we will have the Warrior on the side of Maelstrom down. So this might be an attempt for Tuark to be able to pick up a lot more seeds. They've had a long time before they'll be able to get a Garden Terror. They only have one.
Seeds. Seeds are up. They're there. They're ready to get taken, and we don't have an Arthas. If Tuark kind of just bullies around and spreads out a little bit, a lot of these seeds can actually go the way of Tuark, which would force us into a back-to-back-to-back Terror for their situation. Now, they do got 30 now on the board. If they get either of these big guys, it's just not enough. They need to be able to contest at least one, if not the other, if they do actually want to pick up the rest of those 69 seeds that are ready to go. We do have those Vikings into the mid. One of the big things of the Vikings for a positive change in this patch was the range extension on that Mortar. We saw that in the last fight there, as he does have Ragnar Rock and Roll, and that's going to be a very big, useful tool as we go into these next team fights.
All right, well, we do see that Tuark is taking the seeds from the bottom, but Maelstrom has started to work on that top Shambler. So they, Tuark will be able to pick the rest of those up, and they're already heading to contest. But back in the fight is Uther, so we are going to see a team engagement over these seeds.
We got to get these seeds. Now, if you get a team wipe for the seeds, it's not going to be worth it. Already, Eric is going to be a big target, rooted and stunned. And now it has to be that bolt from Tsukii. He's going to get into that safe zone into the back, but we got Starfalls, we got the Phoenixes. Here's the Ragnar Rock and Roll as well. Two targets, KingCaffeine dropping extremely low. He's still taking those mortar shots, and more mortar shots coming out as that long range just barely does miss out iDream. Now, at the same time, we only lost out Eric. That's actually very impressive there from Tuark, but they need to go back and get the seeds. They don't need to contest this.
No, that was so much damage from that Blizzard, and now Johanna taking so much damage. Deathcoil going to go down to slow, and now she might peek down the indestructible procs, though, so she's got a little bit of time with that shield. Going to try to get out. It looks like she knows that she won't be able to get out, is going to try to just buy a little bit of time for the rest of her teammates, but this could be it.
Yeah, we're looking at a defender disadvantage again. Two seeds is what we needed from Tuark to complete that, and now it will only be a Terror for Maelstrom. So even if Maelstrom's not interested in ending now, a 20-minute Terror at 100% core and no possible real recourse here from Tuark, this is a very dire situation.
Yeah, the Garden Terrors, of course, scale into being stronger the later you go, and this is a very late Garden Terror, but we are still going to see Maelstrom choose to pick up some camps, and that might be a problem there as the Butcher got caught out a little bit, but now it looks like it's K1 Pro might be doing the same, but it will be Chubbs who goes down, so trading one for one there.
He has that redemption ready to go, though. He's actually looking and giving the vision. He's looking for that takedown on top of K1 Pro. The Vikings coming in from the back. There was no boat, however, so they are going to hold on to that cooldown, but again, two seeds. This could have been a little bit more of a stalemate situation for Tuark, but now they're just looking down the barrel of a long garden-esque gun.
Yeah, it was an impossible situation for them. They go in 4v5, and that's terrible. They would probably most likely just lose the game right there, but it's still bad because they still have to deal with that Garden Terror. They are going to get some counter pressure going on with some Merc camps of their own, and no Garden Terror taken quite yet from Maelstrom, as they want to make sure they get all of the camps on their side of the battleground before they do so.
Yeah, so we got the timers will actually start ticking down even after this Terror has now spawned. So we see that, you know, we do have a few of those Merc camps out and about. The Terror now spawn, all the Merc camps go away. So if you take them just before the Terror and you can prolong this phase, I mean, it's going to be a minute 45. It's about a 3-minute respawn on a lot of these Mercs. That means you can get them, you know, pretty quickly after that, after the dust has settled from the next scuffle. And as you can see here, the Siege Giants are just going to throw rocks at each other, but unfortunately, nothing really big to come out of that one. What is the target here for Maelstrom? Are they going for the core, or are they going for that last keep? Because so far, it looks like that push is going to get nurtured top by Fan.
Yeah, I think what we might see is kind of a counter. I thought maybe we would see a push in two different lanes, but it does look like everyone else is coming to support the Garden Tear, which is going to be nice if they can catch somebody out who has been attacking the Tear. This would be great for them. They're moving straight in, and the Vikings are caught a little bit out of position. Here comes the Syndragosa, going to slow down Tsukii. Can he get away in time? Condemn going to try to do so. A Bolt will come out. Going to be safe.
The Vikings feel like they're going in for a snipe, and unfortunately it does look like the snipe will be real on Pannucci. That Furnace Blast is just absolutely insane. There's the Indestructible into the back of it as well. King Caffeine a little bit too far from his team. There's the flank. They're looking for iDream, but he's going to get the Ancestral. The boat is out there as well, but the boat is not going to be as powerful as it could be with only two of those Vikings into it. Lots of heals. There's the stuns. That is the downside of losing your boat in that fight, and this is going from bad to worse for Tuart.
Yeah, they're so low. They have to move back. They haven't taken out anybody on their opposing team. Uther is down, and I don't believe the Redemption is ready yet. The shields have been taken down on the core. The Garden Terror is done. Pannucci's trying to come in. We do have that Flamestrike with Ignite as well, and there is a Starfall trying desperately to zone, but there goes Kael'thas. Tsukii going to be cut out here as well. It's looking pretty dire. It looks like we will have a 2-0 victory for Maelstrom.
Cloud9 Maelstrom, the number 2 seed from June and one of the top teams here in North America, will actually not drop a match up against newcomers here, Tuark, into the June Open, or into the July Open, I should say. And just, you know, this was the Tuark map of Terror with the Lost Vikings. They had the plus 2 advantage, their name is Tuark, and they, you know, really kind of played their draft. Unfortunately, the Vikings are just not in a very sustainable spot right now.
No, definitely not. It was very difficult for them to be able to keep them alive in the lane, and that meant that they missed out on so much lane soak. They got really behind in those talents, and then from there, Maelstrom was just able to really capitalize on it and continue being keeping that advantage.
All right, so Kubi, that 7-on-5 didn't quite work out the way Tuark wanted.
Early game pressure that Maelstrom was able to put out, especially against the Vikings, I heard you guys talking about, you're like, oh, you need to have this advantage getting to level 10. It's important to have that soak, and Maelstrom was able to put enough pressure on during that so that they could keep a mid game that was, you know, very reasonable. They were even actually ahead at that point. But one thing that I want to point out in this replay is making good use of the mechanic of the map, which is, of course, the Garden of Terror. So they had, I think it was Fan actually at this point that was inside the Garden Terror, but, you know, it's a really good sieging tool, but really what is important is setting up, because it's actually very strong in terms of a PvP element. So we're going to pause it right there. And one of the big things that I wanted to talk about is providing enough of an opportunity for Fan to move in to get auto attacks. So we just saw a very, very nice setup. Let's see if I can draw a sweet arrow that comes down here. Boom. It's a little 3D. You guys like that? Okay, good. So we do see a very nice Lunar Flare that comes in, gets the stun on these two heroes, but what this more importantly does is provide a lot of opportunity for Fan to get auto attacks in this Garden Terror, and it ends up doing so much work in this fight. Yes, we can see the silence because of the Queen's Curse, is able to throw down and force to use the Divine Shield onto Kael'thas. They're able to pick up an additional takedown, and these types of things, although the match was very back and forth and Tuark had a fairly strong late game, especially using that Garden of Terror, I think that Maelstrom showed buying a lot of opportunity to get those auto attacks in with the Garden Terror was very important, turning a lot of those fights around.
There was also the fact that Tuark didn't get a Terror until the third night phase. You know, taking a big hero like the Vikings, you're usually like used to a lot of soak, and that soak didn't happen. So because that soak didn't happen, we were always down in experience, you're always getting bullied off the point, and Tuark just unfortunately couldn't put up an early game.
They couldn't, and because they did lose both of those games, we do have a 2-0 victory, but unfortunately for Tuark, they will be moving down to the lower bracket.
All right, so what does that mean? If you are just joining us, we have a sweet, sweet commentator here to show you exactly what that means.
Ooh, yes, let's take a look at the bracket as it's been filled out a good bit. So now all of the round of 8 matches have been concluded. So this means that we'll have Tempo Storm, Goon Squad, Complexity, and Cloud9 Maelstrom advancing into that round of 4. In the lower bracket portion, these guys here, they're not out of the tournament just yet. They have a second chance. We will see PPS up against Cloud9 Vortex and Cognitive up against Tuark. But we need to see these teams advancing through the lower bracket, and they have to beat the team that wins in the upper bracket 2 times. And in order to take the tournament itself. So not an easy task, but very, very doable.
A lot of pressure there on those lower bracket teams. So, you know, we've seen the brackets. We now know who our winner advances are and who actually has to play for tournament life, because up next is going to be Pool Plato, some tangos up against Cloud9 Vortex.
Yeah, and actually, let's take a look at that upcoming schedule, as we will have Pool Plato, some tangos versus Cloud9 Vortex. Of course, this is moving into the lower bracket, so the loser of this will be out of this round of eight. Also, we will take Cognitive versus 2ARC, so that will be our other lower bracket game as well. And then we'll move back up to the upper bracket, and we'll get a couple of really awesome matches, as we'll see Temp of Storm versus the Goon Squad, and Complexity versus Cloud9 Maelstrom.
All right, guys, so we now know who's on deck, who is still left to play. Lots more heroes to come your way. Hopefully you will stay with us and bear with our technical difficulties, because we all love you. We're doing this for you guys. Hopefully you will stick around. And when we come back, the first game of the series will be starting. Stay tuned.